So let's say you just signed up for cryopreservation, or you're considering to sign up for cryopreservation. Why should you care about cryobiology and the research behind it? I'm Emil, founder and CEO at Tomorrow Bio. I'll give you a quick introduction why cryobiology is absolutely crucial to the field of human cryopreservation. It's very important to understand that, kind of opposed to normal medical or standard medical procedures, cryopreservation, human cryopreservation, is a service that you can buy and at the same time an active research problem or a topic. It's basically both. You can sign up for yourself while it's being researched. In the medical field, this is usually not the case. Usually the research is being done first, and then once the research results are sufficiently there, then you start treating patients with this new technology or new drug or whatever it is. There are some exceptions though, and those are usually in cases where people have a terminal disease, and at the same time with any type of standard therapy, let's say for example in cancer, with operation and medication therapy, the current medical system basically doesn't find a solution. So we tried everything, nothing works, the cancer is still growing, it's still spreading, nothing gets better. In this case, even in standard medicine, in the basically day-to-day practice of medicine, it is possible to take kind of, you know, almost unapproved drugs or drugs that are currently in trials under certain circumstances. At least most countries have kind of special regulation for these cases, where if the doctor and the patient decide together, they can take these unapproved medications just because the alternative is that the patient is just going to deteriorate, it's going to get worse, cancer is going to spread further, and the patient is going to die quicker than maybe if you would take that unapproved drug. Cryopreservation, in my mind, should be thought of in a similar way, where it is being researched actively, but at the same time you can do it as basically a customer, as a member. And the reason why this is the case is because if you wouldn't do cryopreservation, then the alternative would be burial or cremation. Because of course, as I said many times before, cryopreservation is only and exclusively done at the time of legal death. So when all the other medical interventions, or for whatever the underlying condition is that, you know, leads to the patient's death, all of those have not worked. And then you do cryopreservation. So for anybody, and in fact everybody, who is interested to be cryopreserved, it is crucially important that that research that makes cryopreservation procedures better is being pushed forward. And to be fair, not only better, the other factor is that cryopreservation, of course, is relatively expensive right now. And research will also, at least that's my goal and the goal of the organization, will also make cryopreservation, at least potentially, more affordable over time. In fact, it might do both. There might also be new research findings that you then implement into cryopreservation day-to-day practice that makes it more expensive for a while. But hopefully then with newer techniques, that cost will come down, or at least it can be a part where costs come down. So cryopreservation research helps with improving quality. And within this long field of, or this kind of umbrella term of quality, I think there are like three main kind of areas of where technology should be improved. And of course, putting aside for now that, of course, research is very much crucially important for revival as well. So these three topics are improving the cryopreservation procedure itself, the cryoprotection. So basically, how can we keep the body without degrading before we have achieved cryopreservation? Then keeping the body in cryopreservation and bringing the body into cryopreservation. So the cool down procedures, there's different types of storage technology that is currently being researched. For example, one being ITS, intermediate temperature storage, one of the topics that we're working on. And then, as I said, last but not least, of course, there's a tremendous amount of research still required to potentially revive someone from cryostasis in the future. Even though, of course, we're an organization that offers cryopreservation kind of as a day-to-day, you know, operations, that's what most of what we do, we're highly, highly interested in the research part as well. And we're not only interested, we have researchers here in Berlin, doctors, engineers. We, of course, do research in our facility in Switzerland. And we fund research at other labs that are specialized on cryopreservation. So at least my time, I would say, you know, 50% or so goes into the medical part, into the engineering part, and into the research part of figuring out what are the things that we can improve where can we dedicate resources and money to make cryopreservation better? And as I said, the second part where research might play a part is bringing costs down. Cost for cryopreservation for whole body preservation in our case is around 200,000 euros as of now, which in my mind, unfortunately, is of course significantly too expensive for at least a part of the population. So my goal is to bring the cost down. I said it many times before. And with, you know, faster techniques, with maybe handling ischemia better, where, you know, taking over the patient with some delay would also lead to good cryopreservation, might have a significant impact here on cost. Again, research might also bring cost up, but then of course also at the same time increase quality. So it's kind of a dual double-edged sword. Research might make it more expensive, but in the long run, I think it will have a bigger impact of bringing costs down. So increasing quality and bringing costs down are two things why cryopreservation research is extremely important for the day-to-day operations of cryopreservation. So if you're interested in the topic of cryopreservation or cryobiology research, it would really help us out if you can engage with us. So ask any type of questions. We're more than happy to answer any questions for either research or, you know, day-to-day practice. And of course, if you want to support the topic of cryopreservation in general, because you might have a contract or you might consider signing up for cryopreservation in the future, then, you know, just with subscribing is already a small amount of help, you know, helping the YouTube algorithm to, you know, show these videos to more people. Our job here is really to educate people and then kind of give them the opportunity to make an informed decision about cryopreservation. Since, of course, a lot of people don't really have a lot of prior knowledge about the topic, it's really, really helpful if kind of these videos that explain at least a certain or small part of the whole topic are being shown to more people. So subscribing and reaching out is always something that helps a lot. So please do so. And again, more than happy to answer all your questions if you want to engage with us and have your personal questions answered. Until then, talk to you soon.